So in the last class, if you remember, that we understood the concept of the boundary layers further, and particularly we looked into the boundary layer approximation. Okay, how the scenarios can be simplified, and what are the logical deduction based on certain approximation. Then we have now we have the conservation of energy equation. So this energy equation you have already done in the conduction part, but now we have convection here. So say if we have a scenario, fluid element that we discussed yesterday. So say we try to apply energy balance in that fluid element. So what are the possible ways that the energy can be transferred? What are the possible ways that you are aware of? From your thermodynamic knowledge,
work and heat.
Work, heat,
and heat.
True. And the way it can be transferred. Do you get my question? The work and heat can be converted into each other. But how the energy, see, the thermodynamics, the basic, the first typical, when I used to teach the conduction part, it till last year, what my introduction was that what is the difference between the thermodynamics class and the heat transfer that you are having? Can you recognize the difference? That in thermodynamics also you are being taught with heat, enthalpy, work and all these things. So what is the basic difference that you have realized? Like why there are two subjects? Anyone?
There is a difference, like, sir, in heat transfer, we basically deals with the rate of heat transfer. So, but in thermodynamics, we don't go with the rate of heat transfer.
We look for that whether the process is feasible or not. We look into that aspect. Okay. But in heat transfer, we mainly concerned about the rate of heat transfer and the mode of heat transfer. How the heat transfer is happening, thermodynamic knowledge would not tell you. There you need the heat transfer where we are concerned about the way it is being transferred, the mode of it, and the rate at which it is happening. Okay, so the point is that when you have the thermodynamics, from thermodynamics you know that also that the E energy, that is energy that comes in, should be energy that is out. That energy balance should happen in a steady process or a steady flow process. Now, how it is transferred? It can happen in three ways. So one is that by heat itself, the energy can be transferred. By work as well as by mass principally. Okay, so the total energy, say, of a flowing fluid stream, okay, per unit mass, if you consider like this, so this you can think of in this way, that if we have a total energy of a stream, you can write it like plus E, which means H is the enthalpy, K is the kinetic energy, and PE is the potential energy. Enthalpy is basically the sum of all internal energy and the flow energy. Fine. Potential energy is Gz, where G stands for the gravitational constant and Hz is the height. Then we have the kinetic energy, which you usually write V square by 2. Okay, this kinetic energy per unit mass of the fluid. Now, usually these parts are very, very small compared to the enthalpy. Okay, so that means, say that if these are very small for most of the common example that we provide, so what happens, we assume that we have a density of a fluid rho, specific heat capacity is Cp, the viscosity of the fluid is mu, and thermal conductivity is K. Okay, then what we can write is that the energy of the fluid per unit mass, we can simply write as the stream is equals to H is equals to Cp. Fine. So now say we consider a scenario of fluid element. We have a fluid element where we have these components that are coming in. So in both the directions. So say the energy that is being transferred by heat, which is coming in x direction, energy transferred by mass that is coming in x direction. This is heat that is going out in x direction. Energy mass that is going out in x direction. So similarly, we write for the y direction as well. So now if this is my x and y, so this distance is basically dx, this distance is dy. So this differential analysis, the differential control volume. Okay, so now if we say usually consider energy balance around this or through this differential control volume, what we typically can write? We typically can write that we have based on this the energy that is in minus energy out by mass plus energy in minus energy out by heat plus energy in minus energy out by work is equals to zero. Okay, so now say if I try to look into the each and every expression, that how do I expand this part? What should I write this part? This I can refer to that this would be the energy multiplied by, because this is per unit mass, so it has to be multiplied by the mass flux, okay, kg per second or kg per unit time. So this stream in x direction, okay, minus this component, because it going out after differential length, which is dx. So if I abbreviate that, d stream, then plus del y del x of stream multiplied by dx. Is it fine? So that implies that this is nothing but still by del x of element, which is rho u, because now we are writing this m dot in expanded form as well. So this comes as, this is the, say, unit depth of the control volume, okay, and this is CPT. Del x we have already written, so this is the dx part. So rho u multiplied by the area through which the mass flux is happening. So we expanded each term here, which means we further can write, because rho and Cp, these are the fluid property. So we can consider that these are usually constant values. So minus rho Cp. And then what you can write is that u del t by del x plus t del u by del x dx dy. Agreed? So this is what, only for the x direction, remember. But this is the transfer by total mass in both the directions. That means now we also have to add with this the y component in order to have the complete result. Now, similar to this x direction that we have achieved, what we can do, we can also find out that what would be in the y direction. And the y direction result would be analogous to this. We will have dx dy. Anyone has any concern? So if we add these two now, because in order to have this part, that is the energy, net energy flow by mass, is the summation of the x direction transfer and the y direction transfer. What would be the resultant? If we add these two, say if I name it as x and this is y. So if I do x plus y, what would be my result? Anyone can help me? Minus rho cp is fine. What I can write here? Anyone? What would be the resultant? We are adding this expression plus this expression.
Capital HD and DX in that.
Sorry?
So capital D by capital X DX, that notation.
That would be with a prefix.
So U dou T by dou X plus T right. Dou U by dou X plus V dou T by dou Y plus T dou V by dou Y del X del or DX DY.
Okay. What if I write only this? If I say this is the result. Do you think this is okay? Do you find a reason or a logic why I discard this part? Oh, sorry.
Continuity equation, dou u by dou x plus dou v by dou y equal to zero.
Absolutely. Because if you take t as common, dou u by the del u by del x plus del u by del y equals to zero. So this part becomes zero from the continuity equation. Okay, so my net heat net rate of say heat transfer by mass is this one. Now if I look into the other part, which is say by heat, second one, the net rate of transfer by heat conduction through a volume, what would be that in x direction? So basically in x direction, if I try to write that I have E in minus out in the x direction by heat conduction, what we can write? It's basically Qx minus Qx plus dou x Qx multiplied by dx. Which is simply if I now say expand Qx, what I can write? What is Qx? Q what is qx? Minus ka del t by del minus ka del t by del x, isn't it? So I have in the x direction. So that is why we have this is del x, this is del. So the area through which heat conduction is happening, dt by dx multiplied by dx. Which means I have k dx dy. Agreed? Similarly,
sir, we are considering this heat due to conduction.
Yeah. The reason is that here we are considering transfer by mass as well. And that can happen if there is flow of mass. Bulk transport or the advection and conduction.
So the advection term is taken care of in the E in minus E out of the mass.
Mass, absolutely. Because advection by definition is the bulk transport of mass.
Yeah.
So in convection, advection plus conduction. This is what we are doing. So similarly, for y direction, the same expression E out in y direction by heat conduction, one can derive this expression. Oh, sorry, well, which means the total rate of heat transfer in y direction, by heat is basically k dx dy. So the differential element. So we have the second expression from this equation. So we have elaborated now the first point, which is this one, and the second one, which is this one. The other mechanism of this energy transfer that can happen in the control volume is by the work, okay, or the work done by the forces that are acting on that differential control volume. So what are the forces that actually be considered in that case? We know those are, we called the body forces and the surface forces. We say those are the body force and the surface force. So these forces, whatever the work they can do, okay, and consequent transfer of heat, whatever that happened. Now, this requires the significant presence of external forces, because the body force that we consider typically the gravity, say the electric force, say the magnetic forces, etc. And the surface force that includes the force by pressure as well. Okay. And the other thing is the viscous shear force. So the pressure and viscous force that we call viscous shear force. Now the pressure, the work done by the pressure is actually is included in this analysis when we added this enthalpy term. Because remember, this enthalpy is the summation of all the fluid internal energy and the flow energy. This viscous shear is usually negligible, okay, when there is low or say moderate velocity axis. At high velocity, this term would appear. But in the cases where we deal with low velocity or say even moderate velocity, we can neglect the contribution of viscous shear force compared to the other two forces or the two scenarios by heat transfer that we have considered. So usually in our formulation, we neglect this third component. This one. This E in minus E out. For that is happening by work. So now that means if we add this 1 and 2 in order to have that what is the net rate of energy, because this holds true, energy in, energy out, and from there we have written here this expression. So if I now summation of these two forces here, remember we have a negative sign here. So what we can write is rho Cp U del T by del A or V dou T by dou Y as per your convention is basically K D2T by DX2 plus del dou T by this expression. So what it tells is that the net energy that is being convected by the fluid out of that control volume is equal to the net rate of energy transferred into the control volume by heat conduction. So this is the diffusive part, convective part, and this is the diffusive or the conductive part. Any question? So this is our energy equation for steady two-dimensional flow, because we considered X and Y with constant fluid property. Remember, that is why we were able to take out this rho Cp terms and the K outside this differentiation. So 2D, steady state, and also it is constant fluid property. Constant properties and negligible shear force or shear stresses. This is the energy equation. Now you can understand, or even you have possibly seen, that in the conduction part, when there is no advective transport, this is zero. It doesn't exist in pure conduction. So you have this form of a 2D heat conduction equation. Are you able to relate that now? Any question, any concern? That for pure conduction, naturally this part doesn't exist. There is no advection. So your energy equation for conduction becomes this one in case of steady state, two-dimensional. Any question?
No, sir.
But when we have convection, this is the energy equation for two-dimensional steady state scenario. Now you may ask, okay, what about the higher velocities? That where you cannot neglect the shear forces or shear stresses. In that case, what happens? An additional term comes in that equation. So in this energy equation, then what we have? Is equals to K. So this was without any shear stresses, but when you cannot neglect, there is this additional term in which the phi is called viscous dissipation function. It has an expression, okay? And researchers have derived that how to estimate that. We will not go into that details, but that expression looks something like this. Del u, del x. Del v, del y whole square. So what happens in case of high speed flow? The viscosity of the fluid, and also particularly when so viscous force actually dominates when you have a higher say viscous liquid, and when there is high speed flow. So in those two cases, these parameters become useful, or it actually is important to consider. What it does is basically that it rises the temperature due to conversion of the kinetic energy to the fluid or the thermal energy. If you have a higher viscous liquid, so you relate this say with the example. When you have your car or say the journal bearing, a high speed car, okay, and you have a lubricant in those bearings. The lubricant on those bearings, if you have seen, you'd realize how viscous those are. In order to avoid wear and tear of the bearings or the those cases, it is a very highly viscous material. Now, say in case of a high-speed car and all these things, what happens? The temperature rises in those areas. Or say the high-speed flight. I mean, we have the aeroplane and all these cases. Okay, so in those cases, what happens? This viscous dissipation, okay, that the viscosity, it actually imparts some energy in terms of temperature rise. That is not, say, we cannot discard that information. In those cases, we say that viscous dissipation is happening, which means the temperature is rising for such highly viscous flow or say high velocity flows. And we need to add this additional term with the energy equation. Okay. So any question on the generic energy equation? Convection, conduction, and with high viscosity and velocity. So for case of
why we
stationary
the body force part completely.
The body force part completely because the scenario is that so in this case, as I mentioned, so here the body force and the surface force. So these are the shear force that I mentioned is mainly for the surface force. Now the body force, when it happens in a fluid, so usually when we consider the convection, it mostly dominated by the bulk transport of the flow. And if you have definitely some dominant external value, external forces, then you would add another term here considering that effect, or you need to have some correlations or the empirical relation that shows you that how much heat transfer or how much heat increase would happen, or the how much energy change is happening due to presence of that thing. So for example, in some cases, if you have the presence of electric field actually heating the fluid, so in that case, you add another term here, like we add for the viscous dissipation case. So those are the special cases, okay? And usually, after the most common flow, we do not consider those cases.
Okay.
One of the examples is such that in future you will hear in microfluidics, there is a term called electrophoresis. There, this heat generation in the fluid becomes a dominant parameter. That means what happens in electrophoresis, that in microfluidic chip or something, that you move the particle by applying electric field in your preferential direction. But this film is so thin because we are considering, we're talking about the micro level. So that effect, the Maxwell stresses due to the electric field, generates heat in the fluid. And then this energy equation is not this simple. Okay, but for the basic level, for the current understanding, we usually consider till this state or till this part. Even we discard the viscous distribution part. Fine, then, man.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay. We have 10 minutes. Now, let me quickly, we'll not go into the derivations. I mean, in fact, these are supposed to be done in the fluid mechanics class. So tell me, what is the thickness of boundary layer when you have a flat plate scenario? You remember that relation, because you cannot forget those, you shouldn't forget those things. So if we have a flat plate, the thickness of the boundary layer, what is this value for laminar flow over a flat plate? Delta is equals to, do you remember this one? Or have you seen this expression? Yes or no? You did it, right?
No, sir.
The thickness of hydrodynamic boundary layer. No? I mean, everybody confident? Okay, fine. So the point is that, again, we will not go into the derivation, but what happens in this case, say, so we have our continuity equation. what is the continuity equation? Prompt from your side as well. This will speeden up the thing. This is my continuity equation. What is the momentum equation? What is the energy equation? Are you convinced when I write this one? Momentum equation. Do you remember? We learned it. Shravandu, are you following?
Yes, sir.
I mean, can we write this one?
So actually, I don't exactly remember, but yes, it was like taught.
It is taught, and the point is that here it is written in compact form, inputting the boundary layer approximation. The approximations that we learned yesterday. That this consideration. So this was the x momentum bound, the x direction momentum equation. And we considered the other approximations that we had clearly is that the v is much lower or smaller than the u component. So in the boundary layer, we write the x momentum equation only, and that too discarding this LP component. So just go back to these notes or the theory book that you are following. You would realize that these things we can write. We now have derived, and we can have it here. So we are here while writing this equation. We also consider that the viscous dissipation is negligible, steady, incompressible, as well as the laminar flow over a flat surface with constant fluid property. There are several assumptions has been inducted in order to simplify the scenario. The viscous dissipation is negligible. It is a steady state scenario, incompressible flow, laminar flow, constant fluid property. Such flow is happening over a flat plate. We write the continuity equation, the momentum equation, and the energy equation we just derived. Plus V del T del Y is equals to alpha is k by rho cp. This expression. Here again, we have applied the boundary layer approximation that del t by del x is much lower than the del t by del y. The temperature gradient in the y direction is much larger than the in the direction of flow, because this is an isothermal surface. So these are the example of implementing boundary layer approximation in our full-fledged governing equation. If we now try to solve, find out that what is the profile of temperature or U, okay, what we have to do in order to solve a set of differential equation or a particular differential equation, what you need? Anyone?
Boundary conditions.
Absolutely. So what are the boundary conditions here? If we say that this is x and y, so at x is equals to zero at this position. Okay, at x is equals to zero, what is the condition? U, we have to write in terms of x and y. So x zero at any position y, what would be the value of u? Tell me, at x is zero at any y, what is the value of u?
That is zero.
Free stream velocity.
Absolutely. And so the temperature. At x is 0, we write these two conditions. At y is equals to 0, at any x, but y is equals to 0, what is the value?
0.
Absolutely. And we, in case of v, we say right here also is 0. Plus the t, x0 is what?
The surface
is isothermal at Ts, it is Ts. Okay. And then the other condition we have, y is infinity, or the this is a flat surface, flow over a flat plate. So we consider that this is infinity. In that case, we write is this condition. Is again the free stream velocity and the temperature. So now this set of equation, using this boundary condition, people have solved it analytically. It's not that trivial. It's a bit complicated with several assumptions. We will not go into the details of that. But you remember one name, because I'm mentioning these names because we mostly or sometimes forget the inventor's name or those who did it. These are solved by a person named Blasius. A German engineer, Blasius. Okay, this is a famous name, and he in fact was a student of Prandtl.
Okay.
So he solved it. Okay, and the point is that what can be shown is the expression that I wrote earlier. After doing several things, is that the thickness of the boundary layer is equals to where REX is basically Y nu. This is nu. Where X is the distance from the leading edge of the plate. Nu is the kinematic viscosity. U infinity is the free stream velocity. So what does this mean? Is that the boundary, the hydrodynamic boundary layer thickness, okay, increases for a particular Reynolds number with X, that as you go along the X direction at a distance farther from the leading edge, your thickness would increase. As you increase the Reynolds number at a certain distance from the leading edge, as you increase Reynolds number, your hydrodynamic boundary layer thickness suppresses. It diminishes. If you have a very high velocity, you can think of that this boundary layer would be suppressed. To be thinner, basically. And also, the coefficient of friction, specifically we call this as skin friction. Okay, skin friction coefficient, which is the wall shear stress, rho v square by 2. Okay, which we say in this case can write rho free stream velocity. Is basically we find a relation which is 0.664 Reynolds number, the local Reynolds number, to the power 0.5 minus 0.5. This relation you have to remember, these two equations. That is the boundary layer thickness for laminar flow over a flat plate and the subsequent local friction, local skin friction specifically, these values. This 0.664 Reynolds number to the power minus 0.5. Okay, so I stop here. If you have any question, because in the next two classes we will continue on these things, we'll use this expression to solve few problems. We will again come back to the energy equation, because now we just spoke about the hydrodynamic boundary layer thickness for a laminar case. What will happen to the thermal boundary layer thickness? What is the relation that with the Reynolds number? We will look into those in the next class. And meanwhile, if you have any question, let me know. So if no questions, then I stop the recording. Okay, and thank you guys.
Thank you.